Hi there. This is Long John Nebel. In the brief period of time available on the two sides of this disc, I'm going to bring to you a picture of one of the most unbelievable things to occur in the 20th century. The fantastic phenomenon of madness, or soul-shaking prophecy of hope or horror. Events which shook this country and most of the rest of the world. It was, of course, the age of flying saucers. Very possibly the most amazing phenomenon in the history of modern times. Sightings of spacecraft from other planets, even other galaxies. Telepathic or mechanical contact with these occupants of these ships. Meetings and speaking with people from other planets. Trips to the other planets in flying saucers, and even wilder. These were but a few of the amazing claims made by the men who created the hypnotic rage of flying saucers and UFOs. I don't buy any of it, but I'll say that only once. From this point forward, you make up your own mind. According to Englishman Desmond Leslie, the first interplanetary traveler, a visitor from Venus appeared on Earth 18,617,841 B.C. Others, like the late scholar Morris K. Jessup, dated the origin of UFOs from biblical times. But in terms of this modern era, it all began with a flying businessman named Kenneth Arnold, who on June 24th, 1947, spotted 9 disks near Mount Rainier. Now, when interviewed about this sighting, he reported that they seemed to skip across the sky like flying saucers. Following this now historical Arnold episode came the tragic affair of the Goodman Field Air Base in Kentucky, when Captain Thomas Mantell, United States Air Force, was sent up to investigate a crimson saucer. Still climbing at 10,000 feet, the captain radioed that it, to quote, looks metallic and it's tremendous. I'm going to 20,000 feet. And that was the last ever heard of Mantell. He disappeared into the clouds and moments later crashed to Earth and was killed. According to one Air Force release, the tragedy had occurred as a result of Captain Mantell's attempt to reach Venus. Yes, you may say that's pretty wild. And of course, there are many, many other things that have happened during this period. Then came the Gorman case, the plane of a North Dakota George Gorman who was repeatedly attacked by a light. During this period, as other sightings piled up, the Air Force established a number of agencies to investigate these extraordinary happenings. But things had only begun to pop. Now opened the era of the contactees. That is, people who claimed that saucers had landed and that they had made contact with the actual occupants. Among the first important of these contactees was Dan Fry. His initial experience took place on the 4th of July back in the year of 1950 at the White Sands Proving Grounds in New Mexico. He met a voice. This is Dan.
I was sent to the White Sands Proving Grounds to set up instrumentation for the testing of some very large rocket motors. On this particular holiday, unfortunately, the air conditioning system broke down and the building became very hot. Figuring that it was cooler outside than inside, I decided to go out and take a hike in the desert air. And I'd gone about half to three-quarters of a mile when I observed an object coming toward me from over the peaks of the Oregon Mountain. I couldn't determine much about it when I first saw it because it was after sundown and the moon hadn't come up yet. I merely saw that there was something there that was obscuring the light from the stars. As I continued to watch it, it grew in size and eventually made a landing about 70 feet from where I was standing. It was completely silent in operation. I observed no jet streams, no propellers, no outward evidence of the application of the force that controlled it. This was extremely startling to me because I had been for some years engaged in the rocket and aircraft industries, and I thought I was at least reasonably familiar with all types of airframe that we were producing or attempting to produce at the time. And this, of course, bore not the least resemblance to any one of these objects. Also, it was coming down too slowly to have been supported by even the most efficient sort of airframe, which indicated that either it was a lighter-than-aircraft or whoever had built it had solved some problems of which our best physicists had only commenced to dream at that time. I almost became convinced that it was and must be a craft from someplace other than this Earth. And understandably enough, I became considerably perturbed, not to say frightened out of my wits. Not quite out of my wits because I didn't break into a run or anything. I remained frozen to the spot. I made all kinds of explanations, saying this was canny thinking on my part. I didn't want to attract attention to myself by breaking into a run, but perhaps the truth of the matter is that I was just scared stiff. Anyway, I didn't move. I saw it come in and touch down about 70 feet from where I was standing. I heard a very definite crackling of the brush as it settled, and this, of course, removed the last possibility that it was, in fact, a lighter-than-air craft. The object was an oblate spheroid, a sphere that is considerably flattened at the top and bottom. It was about 30 feet in diameter at the widest point and about 16 feet in height. On the ground, it had a silvery color. After observing it for some time, not knowing whether to approach it or to get out of there, I found myself approaching it a step at a time very cautiously. I walked up to within a step or two of it and then made a circle about it to see if I could see any doors, windows, or openings of any sort. I didn't see any. It was a smooth, unbroken sphere or spheroid.
In other words, you were the first man to actually have a physical contact with a flying saucer as far as the White Sands Desert was concerned. Then came the high point in UFO history, June 1952. It was a month which was swamped with amazing sightings, climaxed by the events of June 20th. On this occasion, seven blips appeared on the radar screen at Washington National Airport, and jets went aloft to identify the objects which seemed to function as aircraft. Radar observed the blips accelerate from 125 miles per hour to 500 miles per hour, turning at 90-degree angles as they went. At one point, they stopped in mid-flight and reversed the course. At another, they were clocked at speeds in excess of 7,200 miles per hour. No answer, no solution, no explanation was ever provided. On Sunday, July 7, 1952, one Truman Bethrum claimed to have been contacted by a saucer some 300 feet in diameter. It was commanded by a gorgeous female named Aura Raines. Then on November 20th of that year, amateur astronomer George Adamski saw a saucer land, and he met the pilot of Venusian. This is George's description.
A man was up there and waving to me. So I come up to this fella, and he had a funny suit on him, sort of a ski-type suit. And I thought it was one piece. Well, later I have learned it's two piece.
George Adamski, I wonder if you could describe this man in detail to us.
Yeah, a man about 5 foot seven to eight inches, and I would say around 135 pounds of quite delicate hands, tapered fingers, and beautiful, very sharp eyes, looked like they looked right through you. Sometimes you couldn't hardly tell whether he was really a man or a woman. And long hair, waving, resting on his shoulders, he kind of a halfway smile, and put his hand out to shake. And it was a palm-to-palm contact that way, and he smiled. He started telling me things, and I couldn't understand. And I finally got the idea. I wanted to know where he's from. I pointed to the sun, and I made one orbit, called it Mercury, named it, and then Venus, and then Earth, and pointed to myself and the Earth. And then I said, where are you from? He got the idea. He finally pointed to the sun, and he made one orbit, didn't say nothing. He made a second orbit, and he pointed to himself and to that orbit. Then that meant Venus. That's how I knew he was Venetian.
But he couldn't talk to you.
He could talk. He was testing my ability of receiving impressions, he told me later. So he did understand everything I said, except I didn't understand.
When you say impressions, are you referring to
telepathic
communication?
That's correct. All information we receive silently.
George, if you were a little doubtful, did he tell you that he was a man?
He did. But even then, I was a little bit doubtful, but you know, when nature calls, and that way I...
We established that. Well, we got over that.
While we were standing there, talking, trying to get some understanding between us, I saw a flash of lights go out, and I wonder where that come from, just like a mirror would reflect, you know. And I looked around fast, and that's when I spotted the ship that he... that the same ship that I photographed was hiding in this little cove. And I pointed to him, and I said, that's your ship. That's what I said. He nodded his head, and we walked all of 75 to maybe 90 feet from where we stood to this place. And that's where he finally told me to stay away from the ship, not get too close to it. It's unpowered. There was somebody else in it. You could see it. You know, shadow. Somebody else in it. But talking, I forgot all about it. And I somehow pushed over, and this arm got caught under the flange, and the magnetic force, or whatever you want to call it, pulled it up suddenly and slammed it back down. And even now, unaware, sometimes this arm goes limp. He finally went in the ship, went up this hill, see, and went up on the flange there, and there was a door in there, and he went in there, and the way she took off, she went towards his mothership that I mentioned first. Later, I learned how they get in and out. They have hatches at the bottom, or they come out through the side, which is certain, what appear to be portholes, certain openings there. They can come right out of the side or out of the bottom. They usually return on the top, like a flat top, like a carrier, and then slide in down the chute.
The second of the famous flying saucer Georges, George Van Tassel. He met a man from another planet in the following year. This visitor bore the name Sal Ganda. This is the incident as told by George Van Tassel. George, I wonder if you can tell me about the first contact that you had.
Yes, John. This occurred on August the 24th of 1953. At approximately 2 o'clock in the morning. The wife and I were sleeping out in the open in the desert because of the heat in August. I woke up and looked around, and there was a man standing there at the foot of the bed. I said, what do you want? He smiled at me and said, my name is Sal Ganda, and I would be pleased to show you our craft. After I said, what do you want, I never uttered another word during the whole course of this contact. Every time I thought of something to ask, he was answering me before I got the first sentence out.
How did he answer?
The first word. The only English I can compare to his speech was that of Ronald Coleman, who I think spoke the English language as near perfectly as anybody ever did. I tried to awaken the wife, and she seemed to be under some spell. So I got out of bed and walked with him down to the ship 100 yards away, which was a bell-shaped type of craft with portholes up near the top, and was roughly 36 feet in diameter at the rim and 19 feet high on the outside, and inside was circular with a cage in the middle through which a shaft went up into the dome from a rotor in under the deck. And as I approached this ship with this man, I became very nauseated, and this became greater as I got closer to the ship. However, after I passed underneath the ship and stepped on this spot on the ground, which had turned butter color almost, I started to rise up into the bottom of the ship. This man followed me up on an anti-gravity beam. I stepped inside, and as he walked along this wall, he appeared to snap his thumb. And I don't know whether there was a sound that he made, but seats came out of the wall and made a curved lounge. And he did the same thing on the top part of the shelf. And four doors opened with the instruments mounted on the bottom of the doors, and in the open position, placed the instruments before the portholes. And we passed behind the three men who were on the ship, who never got off. The center man apparently was controlling the ship, and the other two were standing beside him. And after we passed the crew, he again flicked his thumb up on the higher wall, and a door slid open, and in this compartment were a number of their uniforms, which appeared to be very similar. The blouse appeared to be very similar to our sweatshirts, of a very close-knit material, and the pants of a similar material, only snug around the ankles. He explained that this compartment cleaned and deodorized their clothing by a density of a light process. I thought to ask him if all of their people were the same height, and before I could get the first word out, he answered.
Do you think that was a coincidence, or do you think he was reading your mind?
Well, I know he was reading my mind.
But you did not receive telepathically?
No, he spoke in the finest English I've ever heard. And then, without any further information on the clothing, he walked to a hole in the deck. He just jumped down and remarked, "Stoop so you don't hit your head." In the center of this catwalk was a big rotor turning. And on the outside of the catwalk was another rotor turning in the opposite direction. Well, I could see where these two rotors apparently were geared together underneath the catwalk in order to coordinate their speeds and counteract the torque so the ship itself wouldn't spin. And this was apparently figured out so that the mass of both were the same, and therefore there would be no torque relative to the structure. This reminded me, I got the thought at the time of Ezekiel's wheels within wheels, because you couldn't describe a planetary gear system any better than saying wheels within wheels or gears within gears. Sure. He stepped by me and climbed up through the hole, and I followed him. And then he walked over to the entry port, and he just stepped in that hole like there was something there to hold him. Well, when I got to the edge of the hole and looked down at the ground, about, I'd say, 14 feet down, I figured I was going to have to light with a normal impact of a jump from that height. So I scooted down on the edge of the hole and then just dropped in a squat position, ready to take the shock when I hit the ground, which would be normal to anybody that wasn't used to this anti-gravity beam. And then he walked back to bed with me and He said they would return. And he walked back to the ship and apparently got aboard. The ship took off on about a 15-degree climb, and in a matter of about 7 seconds was just faded out in the distance. So that was 53.
You said that Salganda said that he would be back again. Has he ever contacted you since that time?
No.